Well, this is nice, isn't it? We're all sitting here together, warm, safe, cozy, dry, inside this building. It's nice. I'd bet the temperature is at about 21 degrees Celsius, what's considered comfortable by those people who make those decisions. We can imagine that a lone building operator sitting back there in front of a computer, computers connected to sensors that are constantly monitoring the temperature, the oxygen levels in this space. And those sensors are sending a live feedback to our building operator saying, optimal comfort levels achieved, all clear. But there's no little wizard behind that curtain. No great Oz controls this building. More or less, the building is programmed to control itself. It's programmed to monitor our activity levels and to respond with a pre-programmed set of comfort controls. So not only does the building assume that we all have the same comfort levels, which is obviously true, but it doesn't even allow us to feel sunshine or a cool breeze, although these lights are getting pretty close. Now look out the window. I'm just kidding, there's no window over there, but we're intrinsically wired to need that connection with our environment to see what's going on around us. And yet we're going to sit inside here for hours and not get to see outdoors. And why? We should be outside. We should be reconnecting with nature. We just went through 8 months of winter hell. And maybe it's not the nicest day of summer, but it's still summer out there. And our brain tells us that we need that connection. We need sunlight and green grass and fresh air. Yet you're all sitting in here and you're listening to me, which is great. Thank you. Don't go yet. So what happened? How did we get here? What happened is human beings started to create this artificial built environment all around us. We build these massive cities, and then we stick ourselves inside these constructs, and that's where we've stayed. And we've lived like this, disconnected from nature and from the environment for so long that we no longer recognize our rightful place in it. We say we love nature, and I think we do. We need that connection. But something starts happening when we talk about buildings that reconnect us with the environment. People start shaking their heads and frowning and saying, no, Lindsey, I don't want that. That's really different than what I'm used to. Well, I'm used to it. For 10 years, I've been in the sustainable building or green building industry. I didn't know much about it at first either. I went into science to become a biologist and then a geologist. And then somewhere along the way, I started working with these people who were designing and building and renovating green buildings. And these buildings were so cool. I started to see how my studies in energy conservation, in ecological and geological systems, applied directly to buildings. And I became obsessed with what I refer to as ecological physics. That's the basic fundamentals of thermodynamics that drive everything on our planet. So for example, we all know that dark objects, they absorb heat, and white objects reflect it. We know that hot air rises and evaporation cools things down, right? We know that every action requires energy. But I also learned that we blatantly ignore all these fundamental principles when we design buildings. And when we ignore physics, we lose energy. Instead of building a building that can interact with the environment as part of that system, we construct them and design them in a way that forces them to act against it. Buildings, conventional buildings, use 40% of the generated energy that we consume. But green buildings, they use less energy, less resources, because they work with thermodynamics in a more natural way. So what do you guys think of when I say green buildings? This? Hey, I stayed in that. It was awesome. How about this? Or this? Well, they're all green buildings. Some of them are pretty conventional looking, but others are a little bit more expressive, more creative. But that perception of what a green building is, it varies widely from person to person. I've sat in design meetings where the client is absolutely sure that they do not want a green building. No, they want a normal building that saves energy. Well, that's a great start. That can be a green building, why not? A building that uses less energy or resources compared to a conventional building. That's what we call best management practices in green building design and construction. Then we get these clients who want so much more. They want a building that interacts with the environment, that produces its own energy and recycles its own waste and recycles its water. They want buildings that allow the occupants, that's you and me, the people, the ability to adjust the interior environment to suit their needs. So that's a building that lets nature into the space. Okay, this is a test. Who can tell the difference between the green fire hall and the not-so-green fire hall? Okay, one of the buildings is obviously a lot newer, and it does have some more advanced sustainability features. But even that old brick fire hall has solar panels on the roof. And it's actually undergoing an energy upgrade to make it more efficient. Regardless of how green these fire halls are, those firefighters eat, sleep, jump in their trucks, and fight fires. The greenness of a building doesn't change the way that we work and live. Buildings will always be part of our habitat, but green buildings have become a more natural, more integrated part of our habitat. So most of my projects, including that new fire hall, they follow green building certification program. And the Canada and US Green Building Councils have gathered data from hundreds of projects across North America over 15 years that tell us green buildings save money and energy, and they actually make people happier. Kids get higher test scores in green schools. Workers are more productive and have less sick days in green offices. That's most of us. And patients recover faster in green hospitals. And sometimes that can be as simple as just giving those people a window so that they have a visual connection with the environment. So this sounds great, right? Why aren't we all over this? Green buildings should be the mainstream, but if you go outside, walk around downtown or through your neighborhood, you'll see that green building is not the mainstream. So why not? We've got every opportunity to educate ourselves on the wide array of green building possibilities out there. And yet very few of us even know the basic fundamental elements of building, or even less how or why we should make these structures more sustainable. So why aren't we there yet? Excuse number one, it's too expensive. Okay, I get that. Everyone wants to save money, I do too. But people tend to focus on the upfront cost of design and construction while forgetting the decades of operation and maintenance costs to sustain that building throughout its life cycle. And green buildings cost less to maintain throughout their life cycle. Excuse number two, it's all a bunch of left-wing health nut hippie crap. Well, I'm no hippie. I don't think I'm a hippie. But I think it's healthier and safer to live and work in a building where there's no harmful chemicals. You know that new car smell that happens when we have new carpet and paint and furniture and curtains? Those are chemicals that make us feel sick and tired and compromise our immune systems. But green buildings virtually eliminate the use of those chemicals in the space. Green buildings provide better air circulation, filtration, and monitoring in fresh air. The green building program I use does not allow toxic materials in the space. Excuse number three, we don't like being told what to do. Extreme ultimatums don't work on us. Change your ways or you will kill the earth. Stop driving, take transit, recycle, compost. Okay, those just make us feel like the bad guy and we resent that. But I think it goes deeper. I think all these excuses are just topical. I think if we start looking deep down in our primordial subconscious, where we don't really like to look, we begin to see that we're not the earth-dominating alpha primates that we should be by now. We're weaker creatures, unsure, at the mercy of the environment. We're afraid what the environment will do to us, what it will take from us. We've lived on the edge of nature for so long, apart from it, above it, protected from us, from it, that we no longer recognize our place in it. We don't feel connected to it. And no one wants to end up in a hostile, dangerous place, a cold, hungry, naked ape. And fear is important. So let's look at those instinctive, primitive fears. Because I think that while conventional buildings have been built to keep nature out, green buildings start talking about letting nature in and reconnecting us with nature, with the environment. So green buildings are actually reminding us of these ancient fears that we've had of nature for millennia. So let's break down a building into these primitive fears. Build with me here. It's a rooftop garden. That's great. That means fresh, local, organic food. But our subconscious starts playing tricks on us and tells us, you don't know what you're doing. You don't know how to grow a tomato. It's because we don't grow our own food anymore. We're disconnected from our food chain. Other people control that now. So our subconscious tells us, you're going to starve. You're going to be hungry. Let's go down to the ground. A key component of green buildings, when they can have the land base to do so, is to provide open space for habitat preservation and biodiversity. It's open space for us to roam around and enjoy the environment when it's not raining. But our subconscious says, we are losing our land. Loss of land means loss of freedom, and that creates stress. So let's go inside our building. So imagine an open workspace, big windows open to let the fresh air and sunlight in. Everyone has a view of the environment through the window, a direct connection with nature. But to alpha members of our pack, this means no more window office. And this is serious. That means a loss of dominance, insecurity, because there was the rest of us. It's interesting. I run into this on almost every project except schools. Because no teacher ever feels entitled to sunlight while denying it to the students. Let's think about water. Green buildings use less water. Water-efficient fixtures, harvesting rainwater from the roof. It means more water is available for the natural water cycle. But on some primitive level, we think, why do we have to save water? Are we running out of water? Is the river drying up? We're going to be thirsty. Same thing happens with alternative energy, green energy. We've got free solar, wind, hydro, geothermal acting all around us every day. That should mean clean air, less pollution. But in our subconscious, it says, why do we have to save energy? Are we running out of energy? Is there a crisis? We're going to have to rely on the wind and the sun to stay warm. We're going to be cold. So we start to see how our instinct to avoid natural hazards begins to affect the way we design and build and occupy our buildings. And a very basic human need is to blend in with the pack. Be one of us, live like us, right? Nobody wants to be that weird antisocial guy living off the grid. But no respectable green builder expects you to give up your creature comforts, possessions, and technologies and go live in the bush. We're not wired that way. We won't put ourselves in the way of a direct threat. It goes against our nature. We're wired to ensure the continuation of our genetic bloodlines and the survival of our species. And so we build to protect ourselves from the environment in order to survive. But I say we can do better. Now, I'm going to take that a step further and say it's the mission of our species to build better. We've come so far, we can take an inherently unnatural object, a building, and actually use it to reconnect us with the natural world. We can use a benign form of control to work with nature to create a built environment that connects us with the environment. We can use these amazing logical brains of ours to build in a way that maintains that balance between finite resources and our biological needs. We're smart enough to make buildings work for us, so let's tell it what to do. Okay? Design that building. Create that open concept with windows that you can open and close when you need to let in the fresh air, to let in the sunlight. Tell the building to recirculate the air. Finish your space with natural, renewable materials. Create a growing wall that's soothing to look at while it generates oxygen for you to breathe. Take advantage of natural solar and wind patterns to help your building passively heat and cool itself. And while you're at it, take advantage of all that free solar and wind and capture it, harvest it, store it, and use it as you wish. All right, design the landscape so that it will actually capture rainwater. And you can sit beside a waterfall or a stream that's designed to flow when it rains. Install motion sensors on your faucet so you can wave your hand magically over it to turn the fresh water on and then off again. And then when you're ready, go up to your green roof or your garden or your sunny atrium. Sit down, relax, and enjoy being human. Just enjoy being human, because we are part of the environment. We need to recognize our place in it and not be afraid of it. We've come a long way. And green buildings, they may reinforce our awareness of natural hazards and make us aware of the error of our ways, but they also offer us salvation. They give us the opportunity to work with nature, to control it, even on a small scale, in order to reconnect with it. So take this time to reconnect. Think about buildings in a new way. The building's in your hand to design, build, and program to suit your needs. So imagine what window you'll open to let nature in. Now, human beings, we're a smart, sensitive species. We can build green. But we hold the power of imagination and innovation to build amazing. Thank you.